This is the king cobra. It is the largest venomous snake in the world.
Nick is under FBI investigation. They've frozen his bank account. He suspects, quite rightly, that he's on a no-fly list, so he's going to be driving from Chicago to Florida.
You can see that all it really wants to do is escape from danger. Its first instinct is to flee, to get away.
But he wants you to give him your real name, to show up to his event where your face will be visible, where your cell phone data will be in close proximity to his.
His head is the size of my hand, and the fangs are long, thin needles that can inject huge amounts of venom.
There it is. If they're looking at his finances, they're clearly looking at his text messages, at the emails he's sending. You think they don't know where the conference is, right? You don't think they could just have people walking around the venue that even if they don't attend, who are keeping tabs on things?
A snake this big can almost stand up and look me in the eye.
But Nick is 100%, 100% under FBI investigation. He confirmed that to me. This isn't me speculating. This isn't me looking at misinformed 4chan screenshots. Nick told me that the feds froze his bank account.
Crucify you.
I mean, I consider Pat a friend. Ever since Washington, it hasn't really felt that way, right? For some reason, which is really weird. He's been really distant and kind of not talking, not inviting us to games or anything like that, you know? I don't know. Haven't really talked to him that much. Haven't heard from him, really. But I don't know. It's really disappointing. It's really disappointing behavior from the self-professed CEO. You know, he had no problem being called CEO for like a fucking year. But now... now we're having like the leadership conference and everything, and he just doesn't want to show up. So I don't know. He's not the CEO anymore. Sorry. Yeah, you're not in charge of shit anymore. Bye bye.
I know that you have never been the biggest fan of Patrick. Other Groyper generals obviously are not the biggest fan of Patrick.
I've tried.
Big Bank, you should have seen Patrick. He was really into it, man. Oh man. That guy can shake it. We're like, yeah, now we're talking. Patrick Casey doing the walk challenge. Now that is something. Oh man. He can back that thing up, man. He can move that thing. He can move that big thing. And we love it. We are enjoying. We are loving that. Holy Patrick, no, not here.
The fact that I tell Patrick some things in confidence about my security or my legal situation or whatever, and he is going to use that, you know, broadcast that all over the internet, all over the airwaves, basically to excuse himself for not going to the conference, this to me is unforgivable.
Patrick Reinhard Casey, traitor, Benedict Arnold, Judas. His name may as well be Rat Casey, with how treacherous and disloyal a snake he's proved himself to be, spreading falsehoods and disparagement upon the name of his leader and rightful God Emperor, Nicholas J. Fuentes, while our most sacred movement was at its most pivotal moment. Let me say right now, Beardson was right to exterminate this parasite from the movement and ascend to his rightful place as number two Groyper General and a true mensch. Patrick provided no evidence of his fanciful and ridiculous claims, and he was thoroughly humiliated and debunked by Nicholas J. Fuentes live on the air on Ethan Ralph's The Kill Stream.
And you know what? I don't think there is a catastrophic risk. I said, I I'll tell you this too. I even talked to my lawyers. I'm talking to four different lawyers right now. It's costing me an obscene amount of money. you know, Patrick said that I'm broke or something. Imagine talking to four lawyers and you know, ask yourself.
I've had to talk to a few recently. Go ahead.
Yeah.
Go ahead,
is it possible to talk to four lawyers if you have $0? I think that would be a...
You know, he made some allegations. First off, he said you were under federal investigation. That was one claim that he made there. I don't know if you want to answer that. Of course, if you were, you probably wouldn't go into great detail about it, but he did make that allegation and said you're putting people at risk, basically, because you yourself, the leader of the conference, was under federal investigation.
Well, here's what I'll say about this, because you're right. When it comes to these matters, I have to be tight-lipped, and I've said this on my show, too. I've said this on my show for weeks. I can't disclose the full nature of everything that's happening behind the scenes. I will tell you that an NBC article claimed that I was under FBI investigation like 4 weeks ago. They did all this reporting about the alleged Bitcoin transfer. You remember that after the Capitol siege. And an NBC report claimed in connection to that I was under FBI investigation. Now, to my knowledge, that's not true. Probably my communications are being monitored. I'm sure my show is being monitored. But to my knowledge, as far as an investigation goes, that's as much as I've heard about it as an NBC report from 4 or 5 weeks ago.
All right. And he also made an allegation. I mean, I guess it's kind of in the same vein, but I guess it's a little more specific, because he claimed that your specific bank account had been frozen, and it seemed to imply that that was one reason you were going ahead with this, to recoup costs or whatever. He actually directly claimed that. So I'll let you answer that.
Yeah, I caught that too. He said that I'm broke, so I'm only moving forward with the conference so that I could fill up my coffers or something. And I will say, I am not taking a cent from the foundation. Good idea.
Now, we're in a specific claim that your bank account was frozen. Now, again, I can't, obviously, you don't have to go there. But he kind of went. That's kind of a really personal claim that he made. I don't know. But yeah, go ahead. I'll let you say whatever you're comfortable saying.
I'll say this much. It's a half-truth. I can't explain the full context of it. It's something that I told Patrick in confidence. Really true. What he said, is not technically true. There is partial truth in it. If I were to reveal the full details of it, yeah, I can't really do that right now for legal reasons. For example, he claimed I was on a no-fly list. That is a bald-faced lie. He says, Nick is on a no-fly list. That is just a bald-faced lie. That's not true. What I said on my show several times over the past couple of weeks is that the Department of Homeland Security revoked my TSA pre-check status. Now, I have to go back and think, what's everything I've ever told to Patrick? And everybody does. Everybody who has ever talked to Patrick Casey, everybody who's ever texted Patrick Casey, everybody who's ever had an email correspondence with Patrick Casey, everybody who is in AIM, everybody who is in Identity Europa, they now have to ask themselves, what did I tell Patrick Casey that could come back to bite me last night? This is just my sober judgment. Patrick is aloof and pompous and antisocial, and for whatever reason, he just doesn't have an ability to connect with people. And I can tell you that everybody has an individual story, a series of gripes against Patrick. And so it's about, you know, am I telling people exactly what they're getting into by going to AFPAC? And the answer is yes. Objection!
All hail God King Fuentes, our noble, divine God Emperor, has proven his regal glory upon the field of intellectual conquest, and has thus vanquished the foolish serpentine knave Patrick Casey, henceforth known as Rat Casey. Long may the exalted Papal King Fuentes reign over us, loyal to him and the white race. And may every Groiper General knee bow and swear our solemn fealty and loyalty to his royal opticalness, the true leader of the movement, Nicholas J. Fuentes.
All embrace me! It's my time to rule at last! 15 years have I been waiting to sit up on my throne. No allegiance, I will swear no oath, from my God, not by the
And so it was that each of the Groiper generals in turn bowed down before Nick Fuentes and pledged their undying loyalty and fealty. Each one stooped down lower than the last into the muck and mire of debasement in order to satiate Fuentes' ego. Fuentes had emerged unscathed from Patrick's snakery, as everything Patrick said turned out to be a lie. There was no FBI investigation. Nick's bank accounts weren't frozen, and he certainly wasn't on any no-fly list. It was happily ever after for the Groiper King.
He suspects, quite rightly, that he's on a no-fly list, so he's going to be driving from Chicago to Florida.
So, this kind of sucks. So yesterday I didn't do a show, of course, because I was traveling to Orlando.
For example, he claimed I was on a no-fly list. That is a bold-faced lie.
But I showed up to the airport today to fly down to Florida from Chicago, where I live, and I was told, basically, that I've been put on a no-fly list by the federal government.
Patrick said that I'm broke or something. Is it possible to talk to four lawyers if you have $0? I think that would be a...
And I can't fly on planes now, and they took all my money, and it's not fair, but...
An NBC report claimed, in connection to that, that I was under FBI investigation. Now, to my knowledge, that's not true.
I know that the FBI is investigating me over the January 6th Capitol situation.
They made a specific claim that your bank account was frozen.
Much. It's a half-truth.
It's not enough. It's not enough that we're banned from everything. It's not enough that they froze my bank account. It's... Because I don't like to lie. I don't like to do the covert stuff. I'm really not cut out for that. Because I'm a very authentic person. We'll talk about the no-fly list situation, which, frankly, I'm like already tired of talking about. Not really. Tim Pool, if you want to hit me up. Elijah Schaefer, anybody. Hey, I'd love to talk about it.
What in the fuck just happened? Well, I'll tell you what happened. Patrick Casey, that Judas, that rat, that evil bastard who needed to be crucified for his sins. He was right. He was telling the truth about everything. Nick Fuentes' bank account is frozen. Nick Fuentes is under FBI investigation. And Nick Fuentes is on the federal no-fly list. Let's take up each of these claims in turn. First, Nick's bank account being frozen. Even from the beginning, Nick said that the bank account being frozen was a half-truth.
Specific claim that your bank account was frozen. Now, again, I can't, obviously, you don't have to go there, but he kind of went, that's kind of a really personal claim that he made. I don't know. But yeah, go ahead. I'll let you say whatever you're comfortable saying.
I'll say this much. It's a half-truth. I can't explain the full context of it.
He said he told Patrick in confidence.
It's something that I told Patrick in confidence.
This ramshackle defense is essentially a full-throated confession that Patrick was telling the truth, but it's coated in thick layers of legalese and plausible deniability, sheer cope. If it was untrue, Nick would have clearly said otherwise. His half-denial, half-true here amounts to a mere pathetic attempt to save face from the reality of the situation. Anyone with common sense can see Nick Fuentes' bank account was frozen at the time Casey claimed. How else would Patrick have known about it if it wasn't for Fuentes telling him? If he was simply making things up, if this was all a pure fabrication on Casey's part, how plausible is it that he'd be totally vindicated on this exact claim, publicly? But 2 short months later, just 2 months later, it's all true, it's frozen, and he admits it.
It's not enough. It's not enough that we're banned from everything. It's not enough that they froze my bank account.
But wait, you might cope. It might have just been one frozen bank account. There's nothing to suggest they seized everything Fuentes had. So, you know, there was no financial pressure to do a risky conference, and there was certainly no chance of being in a vulnerable position to pressure from law enforcement. No, don't worry.
And I can't fly on planes now, and they took all my money, and it's not fair, but...
So there it is, straight from the horse's mouth. The feds took all his money. Not only was Patrick right that his assets were frozen, he was right that Nick was broke, that they had taken all of his money. If you're Nick Fuentes, a right-wing dissident with no money, no options for payment processing, and you've sunk most of any liquid capital you have left into a political conference, could you take the financial hit of canceling your only viable revenue source, or even damaging the returns of it, by being honest about the heightened risks of such an event in the highly charged political climate post January 6th, and with the legal issues plaguing Nick? Not only that, but the knowledge Nick was financially crippled and potentially facing financial crime charges, domestic terrorism charges, bogus or otherwise, opens up the distinct belief that Nick could have made a deal with the feds for funding or potential immunity in exchange for delivering his supporters personal details and their photographs from the upcoming AF PAC 2. Regardless of whether or not you buy that theory, it's clear that when it comes to Nick Fuentes having his bank account frozen in January, he is 100% beyond any shadow of a doubt. Now, let's take a look at Patrick's other claim that Nick was under direct FBI investigation before AF PAC 2. Now, anytime the feds are invoked as being involved in something, or somebody's a fed, or, you know, it evokes a healthy amount of skepticism. So let's hear once again what Nick had to say on this topic in January, just for the record.
I will tell you that an NBC article claimed that I was under FBI investigation like 4 weeks ago. They did all this reporting about the alleged Bitcoin transfer. You remember that after the Capitol siege. And an NBC report claimed in connection to that, that I was under FBI investigation. Now, to my knowledge, that's not true.
Now, I don't know about you, but if I had a mainstream news organization like NBC reporting that I was under investigation by the FBI, I'd assume, you know, I was most likely under FBI investigation, and I'd operate accordingly to that, especially if I was at an event that was categorized as domestic terrorism and an insurrection by the feds not even a month prior. An event, mind you, that's led to multiple public investigations and charges being laid publicly against attendees. But notice the way Nick frames this. To his knowledge, it's not true. To his knowledge, It's a very lawyerly way of phrasing a denial, don't you think? It's the sort of denial a guilty person would give, right? Because this allows him to say later, like he is now, that, well, yeah, I am under FBI investigation, but I had no idea I was under investigation before the conference. Just ask yourself this. Put yourself in his position. If you one day had it reported by NBC, you were under FBI investigation, and you knew, on top of that, that your bank account had been frozen around that time, which we now know was undeniably true, would you not conclude reasonably you were under FBI investigation? This can't be dismissed out of hand as just a fake news report by the lying liberal media, because there's smoke here. His bank account was frozen. A person's assets are not just frozen for any reason. Typically, the only way this is going to happen is somebody either not paying their taxes or being under investigation for financial crimes or other charges that would necessitate limiting the suspect's access to his capital. This is not an everyday occurrence for an innocent Joe Blow American. You can't just say, my bank account's frozen, it's no big deal. No, it's something that's deadly serious. For Nick to claim he had no knowledge of being under investigation while his bank account was frozen, and it was being reported in the mainstream news to everyone, this claim is simply laughable. But don't worry, surely an active investigation by the federal government, it doesn't raise the risks of holding a dissident political conference at all. Don't worry.
My communications are being monitored. I'm sure my show is being monitored.
Think about what he just said. Just think about it for 2 seconds. Just 2 seconds. So his communications are, by his own admission, being monitored by the FBI. But he wants the responsibility of organizing a conference of political dissidents. If Nick's communications, his own personal communications, are under surveillance, then every person communicating with Nick to organize AF PAC 2 was under surveillance. And any data on Nick's phone or any of the organizers' phones would be available to the FBI, including the real names of each of the attendees that were provided to the America First Foundation on their checks, on their payments, not to mention organized by order number photos of each of the attendees' faces in direct photographs with Nick, an individual who, as we all know, was at the January 6th insurrection. So this ties every attendee of AFPAC 2 to the broader spiderweb investigation into domestic terrorism by the FBI, who is having serious resources put into it under the direction of the Biden administration.
I know that the FBI is investigating me over the January 6th Capitol situation.
Regardless of whether or not Nick was actually cooperating with the feds or stonewalling them, it was a serious dereliction of responsibility to go ahead with a dissident political conference while under direct federal investigation. He endangered each and every one of his most diehard followers in order to enrich himself. And folks, that's not leadership. It's willful negligence. To believe he had no idea he was under investigation, despite overwhelming evidence to the contrary, his bank account being frozen, his TSA pre-check being revoked. It's simply naive. And therefore, when it comes to Patrick's charge that Nick was under investigation by the FBI, beyond any shadow of a doubt, Nick Fuentes is... Well, what about Patrick Casey's final charge that Nick Fuentes was put on a federal no-fly list before AFPAC 2, so that's why he drove to Orlando? I mean, that couldn't be true, right? the no-fly list, it's for terrorists, ISIS, Al-Qaeda, those types, right? I mean, Nick himself told us this.
This thing. He says, oh, and Nick is on a no-fly list. That is just a bald-faced lie. That's not true. What I said on my show, several times over the past couple of weeks, is that the Department of Homeland Security revoked my TSA pre-check status.
Him being on the no-fly list, it's simply a bald-faced lie. There's no validity to it whatsoever. No reason for any reasonable person to possibly think he was on a no-fly list before AF PAC 2. You see, there's an easy way to prove someone isn't on a no-fly list. For them to fly! Nick used this exact same line of logic when debunking Jared Holt's claim that he had been put on a no-fly list. This was after an incident in early December where Nick refused to wear a mask and he was kicked off a flight for it. Fuentes correctly debunked this by stating he had been on 7 flights since that incident and therefore logically couldn't have been on the no-fly list. So it's pretty simple. January 6th was the date of the incident that led to Nick being put on the no-fly list, allegedly. AFPAC 2 was on the 26th of February. So as long as Nick took a flight between January 6th and February 26th, he couldn't possibly be on the no-fly list. So when was the last time Nick Fuentes flew on a plane?
I was put on the no-fly list, apparently, at some point since the Capitol riot on January 6th, because that's the last time I flew on a plane.
Well, fuck me! Fuentes not only didn't fly between January 6th and February 26th, he hasn't flown since the 6th! He didn't attempt to fly on any airplane from January 6th until April 27th. That's a 111-day gap. It's a pretty unusual gap for a political activist who flew domestically 8 times in December alone. And he had his largest political event of the year scheduled in between those dates in a location that was over 20 hours away by car. Nick explained to Glenn Greenwald via Twitter that he had his TSA pre-check revoked sometime in January, which means he hasn't attempted to fly since that pre-check was revoked. This also confirms that Nick Fuentes did drive to AFPAC 2, as Patrick predicted he would. You know, if Nick felt he would have had no difficulties flying, other than having to take his shoes off and his laptop out of his carry-on, why did he feel the need to waste 18, count them, 18 extra hours driving over flying the week of him being the primary organizer for what you can only assume is a massively time-consuming political conference? Well, let's let Nick himself explain. Take it away, Nicker.
And some people alluded to AFPAC. Some people were claiming during AFPAC that I was on a no-fly list and I knew that and I wasn't telling people. I didn't know that at the time. And if people said that I told them that, they're lying because I didn't know that at the time. You know, if I did know that, I would have driven to Florida this time. I didn't know. You know? I assumed that I was just being overly cautious when I went to AFPAC, which I was. I said, I'm not taking a chance. I drove to AFPAC. This time I said it'll probably be fine.
So wait a minute. By his own admission here, Nick wasn't taking any chances by attempting to fly to AFPAC 2, which means by his own admission, he had a fear he was on the no-fly list. But remember...
Well, for example, he claimed I was on a no-fly list. That is a bold-faced lie.
I don't know, folks, but can it really be a bald-faced lie? A total fabrication to say he was on the no-fly list when Nick Fuentes himself clearly considered it a credible enough possibility that he wasted 18 hours of the busiest week of his life driving to Florida. And he didn't attempt any flights for over 3 months. You know, to say Nick Fuentes had no knowledge of being on the no-fly list is the equivalent to a man finding a tumor in his testicles, a huge growth in his testicles, and refusing to go to the doctor for 3 months because he's afraid he has cancer. You know, watching the tumor grow larger and larger each day, until the man finally goes to the doctor 3 months later and is diagnosed with cancer. It's like saying that man had no idea he could possibly have cancer. In other words, it's entirely laughable. And in both cases, it's recklessly negligent. Think about what we now know about Fuentes at this time. His bank account's frozen, he's under FBI investigation. Now he's had his TSA pre-check revoked. By the way, a TSA pre-check isn't just revoked for no reason. You're removed for violating federal security regulations. And, you know, since the events on the 6th are considered domestic terrorism by the Biden administration, Nick's involvement in it is the easiest explanation for both this revocation of the TSA pre-check and his appearance on the no-fly list. And chances are, these actions taken by the feds might have been different agencies, but they occurred around the same time, chances are. So, you know, with his bank account frozen, under investigation, TSA pre-check revoked, for Nick in that context to claim there's no possibility he's on the no-fly list, to the extent that when Patrick said that, it's a bald-faced lie, when Nick says that, in and itself, it's a bald-faced lie. And it's a bald-faced lie that left his own viewers, his own supporters, uninformed about the possible risks of attending AFPAC 2. So when it comes to Nick Fuentes being on a no-fly list before AFPAC 2, he's undeniably... So where exactly does this all leave us? Well, it leaves us with Patrick Casey being completely vindicated on all of his claims. He blew the whistle on risks to the America First movement that Nick Fuentes wanted to remain hidden to his unsuspecting audience. As a result, Patrick Casey was publicly tarred and feathered by Nick Fuentes and all of his contemporaries. He was excommunicated from the America First movement. And as a result of that, it leaves us with a massive indictment on Nick Fuentes' leadership that Nick would directly lie to his audience rather than do the responsible thing and postpone his conference until the legal questions surrounding him were resolved to the satisfaction of all the Groiper generals and advisors. Instead, he decided to suppress the truth, leading to a split in the movement, the loss of a reliable spokesman in Patrick Casey. But this also leaves us with two very pressing questions. Firstly, why did Nick lie about all this in the first place back in January? And secondly, why did he choose now to come forward with his twisted version of the truth? Well, let's examine firstly why he lied in the lead up to AFPAC 2. The simplest motive for this cover up of the truth by Nick Fuentes is financial. The man who was telling you the truth this whole time, Patrick Casey, said himself that the reason Nick Fuentes wasn't disclosing the full truth was that he was on the hook for massive expenses related to the conference's security, the venue, catering, other miscellaneous costs. With his assets frozen, Fuentes could hardly stand to take the full financial hit of those expenditures. And with all forms of online payment processing suspended, his merchandise store temporarily shut down, the only potential source of liquid capital he had was the cash and check sales of AFPAC 2 tickets. To halt the conference would hurt the flow of that desperately needed cash. Nick Fuentes chose his bottom line his monetary interests over the safety and well-being of his most loyal supporters. That's the truth, plain and simple. A secondary motive for Nick Fuentes going ahead with the conference and covering up the truth is simply to save his own ass from the federal government. Knowing he was under investigation by the feds, Nick knew any info he collected on his own dissident supporters would be highly valuable in a potential negotiation with federal agents. Going ahead with the conference allowed Nick to collect the real names, the financial details, and facial photographs of his dissident supporters, a highly valuable bargaining chip towards unfreezing his assets or obtaining criminal immunity. Nick's close friendship and business partnership with Sines v. Kessler federal informant Milo Yiannopoulos, who has just so happened to be known to keep a personal hard drive of blackmail on his associates and partners, certainly does nothing to alleviate these potential fears either. But still, a question remains. Why admit this now? Well, firstly, the AF PAC controversy is now safely months in the rearview mirror. Patrick has been quietly excommunicated from the movement, and all questioning of Nick's behavior during that time can now be easily dismissed as old drama or fanboys of Patrick. Nick couldn't hide the truth forever, and so it makes sense to release this info in a controlled way that benefits him. But how could he possibly benefit from the release of this damaging info? Well, one word. Martyrdom. He received a massive outpouring of support and huge publicity from established Republican names who otherwise would never have mentioned his name. They're told not to mention his name, but they are now. And as a free bonus, he gains protection from any claims he's a federal asset. Because why in the world would the feds put one of their own on a no-fly list? Can't possibly think of a reason why. You know, this sort of martyrdom is priceless to Nick Fuentes. And all it cost him was the price of a couple plane tickets, some dirty laundry coming out that was buried by his martyrdom anyway, and it was inevitable it was going to come out, and missing out on an event in Florida. And this event in Florida wouldn't really benefit him very much anyway. They didn't even need him. It's the perfect crime. Allow me to go full tinfoil hat on you fine people for a moment, because I don't think Nick Fuentes ever was supposed to be on that plane to Florida. I mean, just look at the event he was supposed to go to. All three of the headlining speakers are female. He sticks out like a sore thumb. One of these things is not like the other. It's a bit superfluous, to say the least. Not to mention, the other three are a Jew, a Filipino, and a recovering heroin addict. Strange bedfellows for a white nationalist, to say the least. And look at the sudden, spontaneous outpouring of support for domestic terrorist Nick Fuentes from established Republican names Tucker Carlson, Dinesh D'Souza, Glenn Greenwald, people who normally are forbidden from speaking Fuentes' name or just don't want to, but suddenly are now giving him all the publicity he could ever dream of. But why? Why is this happening? Well, I think that Nick Fuentes has potentially made a deal with the federal government to act as controlled opposition. Potentially he reached this deal by handing over America First dissidents' info, but regardless, he's now being promoted as the face of white nationalism, a new generation David Duke boogeyman for the progressives. It's all being pushed by the mainstream media machine now. This all seems to me like a coordinated publicity stunt. The first step towards making Nick that new boogeyman. Just listen to Nick's reaction to being put on the no-fly list. Does he seem here in this clip like he's upset about it? Or does he seem like he's more excited about it than anything? Like it's an opportunity. Just have a listen to this here.
We'll talk about the no-fly list situation, which, frankly, I'm like already tired of talking about it. Not really. Tim Pool, if you want to hit me up, Elijah Schaefer, anybody, hey, I'd love to talk about it. And I booked on Southwest, yet another, a third airline. And actually, this time, honest to God, I went over there to record it. I went over there to film the encounter so that if they told me I wasn't on the flight, that I would have proof. And I was a little bit nervous because, you know, what I had claimed in the morning was, I'm on a no-fly list. And, okay, I'm on a no-fly list. And so I said it kind of cavalierly, and people were doubting it. And some people said, oh, well, maybe it's an airline. Maybe you don't know what's going on. And so I actually got a little bit nervous because I'm thinking, what if I go to Midway and I book this Southwest flight to Phoenix and they get me on a plane? I said, then I'd look like a total idiot.
He's excited. He can't wait to milk all the publicity he can out of this. And did you hear him? He was nervous. He wouldn't be on the no-fly list. Who would be nervous to find out they weren't on the no-fly list? You know, for most people, being put on the no-fly list would be an epic, near life-ruining disaster. It'd cause you a lot of stress. You'd be really worried about the consequences of being labeled that. But for Nick, he's worried about getting the camera footage for his publicity stunt so he doesn't look stupid. I mean, folks, it's clear. This isn't the behavior of an oppressed political dissident down on his luck, broken, humiliated, deprived of his rights. This looks like the behavior of a ruthless opportunist who sees an opportunity and is going to exploit it for all it's worth. Surrounding all of this is that for all the talk of stringent security measures that were put into place at the AFPAC, Vincent said it, Nick said it, we were assured everybody would be kept private, everything would be private. Somehow, this man, Louis Theroux, the BBC journalist, the documentarian behind many anti-white advocacy propaganda hit pieces, such as Louis and the Nazis. He was allowed full backstage VIP access with a camera crew to film AFPAC 2. This is the next major piece in establishing Nick Fuentes as the David Duke-esque boogeyman for a new generation. And what a hit piece it's gonna be.
Fucking gay. Twitter is fucking gay. Twitter is fucking gay. Twitter is fucking gay.
Okay, one more time.
Come on, I can't.
IP2 always wins.
What does it mean? Tell me what it means.
It's the website.
All right. If I say it, then I'm not endorsing it.
No, you're not.
IP2 always wins.
Let's go. Yes. All right. Okay.
Alexander says, what's Louis Theroux like? Is he doing a documentary with you? He is. I think I could say that. I don't know. I mean, in so far as I've talked to them, their team is nice and, you know, he's inquisitive, but it seems like some things he's kind of open-minded and a good sport, and then things that are more political, he comes in there with an agenda, more or less. And even some of the questions he's asking me and other people that were at the conference, I mean, he was asking Laura Loomer, like, oh, you're Jewish, why are you here? Really, dude, you know, like, when I get talked to by a journalist, it's,
what do you have to say that you're a white supremacist? And tell me about Charlottesville, and tell me how you're not the alt-right, and blah, blah, blah. Come into this thing, and some of the questions they're asking, they're like, oh, you're black, why are you here? You're Jewish, why are you here? Implying what? That we like hate Jewish and black people? I mean, we may talk about Jewish power, and we may talk about black crime, but I wake up every day animated by racial hatred. You know, I mean, that's just retarded, frankly. So if we wind up doing something with them, it's like a big deal. It's like a historical thing. So why not, you know, invite him into our world? But I don't think that, here's what I'll say. I don't think that anybody is ever going to show anything sympathetic about us. You know, I think that at best, it's not going to be a total hit piece, right?
For all the juvenile gesturing on Fuentes and John Miller's part about going Joker mode and trolling Louis with our epic gamer skills. It's Joker mode, dude. Make no mistake. This is going to be a hit piece, smear job, on the highest of levels, made by a master of his craft, with over a year of footage to work with, to allow America First to hang itself in front of a massive mainstream audience. It is beyond the pale of any reasonable metric of security, responsibility, leadership for Nick Fuentes to allow Louis Theroux, a BBC journalist, into AFPAC 2 under any circumstances. But to not even warn the ticket buyers in advance of this journalist's presence, this liberal journalist's presence, shows a shockingly cavalier disdain for his own followers' privacy, their security. This, quite frankly, should make Nick Fuentes lose sleep at night. To put a wrap to this whole thing, I just want to say that regardless of whether Nick Fuentes is a federal asset or not, he's acted in a highly dishonest, dangerous way with his supporters' privacy and safety. As a result, he's lost any legitimate claim to leading any sort of movement, let alone the movement. And listen, if you out there are listening to this and you're standing with Nick Fuentes now, I just want you to realize the problems you have in life, and each and every one of us is different. Those problems Nick Fuentes isn't able to fix. He was never able to fix them. And the goals you have for the future of your country, your society, your family, they can and must be accomplished away from him.